From Birds Canada, this is The Warblers. This is The Wake Up Call, a special podcast series from The Warblers by Birds Canada. I'm Andrea Gress. Join me as I speak with experts about our most threatened bird species, why these species are at risk, and what conservation actions are being taken. And finally, what we can all do to help. Welcome back to another episode of the Warblers podcast. Maybe you've been listening for a while and you can recognize that theme music. Yes, this is a wake-up call episode. The idea behind wake-up calls is that we take a deeper dive into an at-risk species here in Canada. Often these birds are lesser known, like the roseate tern or the Bicknell's thrush. But we've also had what I consider bird celebrities featured, birds like the burrowing owl or the piping plover. But generally what they all have in common is that their populations are declining a little bit. They can use some extra love, some extra help and support. So that's why we like to feature them in these wake-up call episodes. Today's bird is somewhat elusive, but not to the same degree as something like the roseate tern. It's actually really quite an exciting species because it's one that I think is lesser known, but can be seen throughout much of Canada. We'll be talking about the olive-sided flycatcher today, so get ready, seatbelt in. I've got Jody Allair joining us today. You've heard him on the podcast before. Jody is our Director of Community Engagement here at Birds Canada and also one of the producers of the podcast. Well, I'm much newer to the birding world. Jody has been birding since childhood, and whenever we catch up, he's always bursting with such interesting bird facts and knowledge. It never ceases to amaze me. So I'm excited to have him on today to talk about the olive-sided flycatcher. Welcome back to the podcast, Jody. How's it going?
I'm great. Great to be back on the podcast.
Always good to have you. Today, we've got you on to talk about the olive-sided flycatcher, which I know that you're an absolute nerd about these birds. What makes them so special?
You know, they really are special. And I feel like I could say that about so many birds, right? Birds are the best. Olive-sided flycatchers are incredible. And like, I really love the way they look. Like, they're really impressive, long-winged, very stately-looking birds. And especially when they're perched on top of the treetops, like they're, you know, they're the champion of birds almost. But in terms of migration, like they kind of are. They travel huge distances. They spend a lot of time on migration, and they're built for it. And then they live in these just amazing wild places, especially found in the mountains and in the boreal forest regions. And they have such an iconic song for me, you know, especially like growing up in central Ontario and spending a lot of time up in Algonquin Park and those areas, like hearing olive-sided flycatcher was that amazing kind of bird song of summer for me. And I don't know, I've always loved them. And I love that we have this great opportunity to talk more about them.
Cool. Yeah. So they look impressive. They sound great. And they're found in really cool locations. I mean, those are the hallmarks of an awesome bird. So a little bit more, what do they look like? How can people tell them apart from other birds?
Sure. Yeah. So they are a flycatcher. And they're not, you know, orange and blue and yellow stripes. Like, they don't, you know, they're not a wood warbler, right? They don't have those colors. They're not a mountain blue bird. But I got to say, to me, they hold their own. Yes, they are a few different shades of gray. But they are very long winged. So they're actually a flycatcher, and they're a really good size, about 18 to 20 centimeters in length.
Okay.
They weigh, you know, 32 to 37 grams, which I'm sure doesn't mean much to people listening, but that's about the same weight as a 60 watt light bulb, which is actually, that's a pretty hefty songbird, to be honest. Although in the grand scheme of things, like, can you believe a bird that only weighs like, you know, 30 grams is migrating from South America and back and forth like every year? It's just incredible.
It's kind of hard to imagine. I have to change a light bulb in my lamp soon, and I'm picturing that as a bird now.
There you go.
Like, I guarantee when I do the light bulb switch, I'll be picturing an olive-sided flycatcher.
Imagine that, olive-sided flycatcher. That's right, in the light socket. They've got a really cool crest. They've got a huge bill because they actually go after really large prey, large insect prey, which we could talk about. And then, of course, they've got those olive sides. They've got this really cool vest appearance. So they really actually are dressed up pretty nice. And it, to me, it's less about color and more about their posture. They're very vertical. They're very aware and alert, and they're sitting out in the open all the time, always looking for food. And yeah, that long winged appearance, you know, they're a large, large flycatcher, and they're pretty cool.
Yeah, kind of regal the way they perch on branches.
Yeah,
cool. And a big key to identify them is their sound as well, right?
Love their sound. Oh, it's one of my favorite songs. It really is. You know, and the, I know at some point we should do a top 10 favorite songs at some point, maybe.
Yeah,
that'll be a contentious one. Holy cow. It's definitely within my top 10. And it's the classic quick three beers. And it's a really interesting song. And the and just one neat fact about this song is that it actually, there's a couple different versions of it. There's the classic, very clear quick three beers, which you hear throughout Eastern and Northern Canada in the boreal forest in East. And but then there's a Western version, really Alberta West and then South through the state, especially through Southern California. And it's a little bit slightly different version of the song. And it's a little bit, it's still quick three beers, but it's got a bit more of a slur to it. So there's actually a couple different song types for Olive-sided Flycatcher, which is pretty interesting.
So you could kind of remember that as like the Western birds maybe have had a quick three beers in their system already. And so they're kind of slurring it.
That is a great way to remember it for sure. Yeah. it's certainly subtle. If you hear comparisons, you can definitely tell there's a little bit of a difference. What that means, we still don't know, but it actually raises some interesting questions about why is that song a little bit different, and what could we be looking at here with this species? I don't know. Some interesting things to discuss, maybe at a later time.
Yeah, that sounds. So I think we could do a whole episode about like bird sounds and songs and why they differ and where they learn them and all those kinds of things. So definitely, that's an episode to come. You've mentioned that they're up in the boreal forest parts of Canada. Will people see them across the country?
Yes. So this is a very widespread species across much of northern Canada. Really, anywhere you get into the coniferous forest region across the country. So, the only places you won't see them in terms of nesting would be the prairies and in like southwestern Ontario. But otherwise, you'll see them right across the country, and they go all the way up into Alaska. So they're throughout the boreal, they're throughout the coniferous forest region, even just south of the boreal. And on migration, you actually have a very good chance. And I think for a lot of people, migration is the time when people see them, because they do have this protracted migration. It's kind of, they take their time getting up to the boreal and we're recording this, June 12th. And there are still olive-sided flycatchers arriving into Canada right now. I actually just had one in just near my house a couple days ago on migration, which was
out by Drumheller there.
That's right. Yeah. And nary a coniferous tree to be found like around here.
Yeah.
And it was just hanging out in the park on, dead cottonwood branches at the very top doing what they do, right? You can almost pick them out just by looking for these tall flycatcher sitting on top of bare branches. Like that's what they do. And so on migration, they're coming through in the spring. And then in the fall, they actually start their fall migration as early as late July, believe it or not. And they start heading south.
Wow.
Yeah, I actually see most olive-sided flycatchers in early to mid-August, whether I'm in southern Ontario or even southern Alberta. Usually that time of year is the best time to get them on migration. So if you're not lucky enough to live in the mountains or in the boreal forest region, catching them on migration is actually, I'm not going to say easy, but it's a regular occurrence if you're looking for them.
It sounds like they must have a really efficient nesting period if they're arriving so late and then taking off so early. It's really fascinating.
You know, they do. They only have, you know, a lot of songbirds, you know, some birds will try to have, you know, two or three clutches of eggs of young a year. You know, robins are usually good for two to three nests. But olive-sided flycatchers are not. Olive-sided flycatchers are one nesting attempt. They have one clutch and that's it. And it sort of just fits their MO. They are a constant wanderer. They are a super migrant. All they are doing is wandering north and wandering south. And they spend such a short period of time in their breeding grounds. They just have one clutch, one batch of young, and then immediately start heading south. And I think they're kind of a perfect example of a bird. You know, we like to think of, you know, what birds are our birds, you know, what birds, you know, are Canadian birds versus American birds versus, you know, birds in the tropics. And this bird just crosses all those boundaries, right? It olive-sided flycatcher belongs to the Western Hemisphere, right? Between its time in South America, wintering in its non-breeding area and on migration, it spends more time for sure away from its breeding grounds than on the breeding grounds throughout the year. So it's just a constant traveler. It's a super cool bird.
Yeah. So, I mean, they can't really waste a lot of time in the breeding grounds because they do have a long migration. Where are they headed to?
Yeah. Oh yeah. So they go a long, long way. That's right. So in the fall, they finish nesting and then like immediately the adults leave and followed weeks later by the young who just somehow know like they have to migrate to South America and they're nocturnal migrants, right? Like many songbirds, which is, and I think we've talked about this before. It's a perfect adaptation, especially if you're trying to avoid predation. You migrate at night. You use the Earth's magnetic field. You use constellations. You know, you navigate by the stars, and then you spend time during the day getting food, fattening up, and you migrate at night. No predators, no food. It makes total sense. So, so they start heading south, and they like all go through Central America. Some would go through the Caribbean, and a lot of them are heading to the northern half of South America, particularly the Andes, the Andes mountain range, you know, from basically Peru, you know, Western Brazil, Colombia, Ecuador, you get them in Panama, you can get some in Costa Rica up in the mountain ridges as well, but they're really heading for those tropical, that massive tropical mountain range in South America. That's their home for the non-breeding season, and it's quite a journey. But they don't rush there; they sort of take their time, which is kind of neat.
That is interesting. I know some birds will go really, really direct, so it's cool that they're taking their time. They love a pretty landscape, by the sounds of things. Got to respect them for that.
Oh yeah, for sure. Right, like they go the most, you know, the most beautiful places, right? On migration, in the nesting season, and in the non-breeding season. Like, yeah. So can you pick better landscapes? I don't think so. Like, they know what they're doing.
No, not at all. And so these guys are aerial insectivores, which is a type of bird we've talked a bit about on the podcast recently. It's a group of birds that is generally in decline. But something I find interesting about this aerial insectivore is that they eat bees. I was wondering if you wanted to get into that a little bit.
Yeah. No, and I don't know a ton about all their diet, but one of the things they're known for is that they're bee specialists. And there are birds out there in the world that are known for prioritizing going after Hymenoptera, going after bees and wasps and hornets. Mm-hmm. And the classic one is the bee eater, right? That you get in Europe and in Africa, which are ridiculously amazing looking birds, like the coolest, and watching, you know, getting to see them catch food and rip the stinger off. It's just incredible. Well,
bizarre.
It's totally bizarre, but boy, if you can pull it off, what an awesome food source, right? Like that's a hefty meal. Mm-hmm. And olive-sided, olive-sided specialize in going after bees, but they'll go after everything. I've seen them go after dragonflies. They'll go after smaller insects, but they have a very large, chunky bill, and so their bill strength and size is one attribute to help them do this. But the other one is they are pro flyers with those incredible wings. If you ever see a photo of an olive-sided with the wings out, you would be shocked. You know, they look like a fighter jet. Like, it's incredible how long the wings are. And they, one thing they do is that they will perch in an exposed treetop or bare branch and be looking for food. And then they fly out, they glide out lightning fast, grab it, and then bring it back to the perch. And it's called sallying. When they leave a perch, grab something and arrive back at the perch. And they do it with lightning speed. They're constantly looking for that food. And that's how they hunt a lot of bees and wasps. They just sit there and watch. And when they see one, they dive at it really quickly, bring it back, have a good old snack, and then wait for more.
And do it again. So a little bit different from birds we've talked about recently, like a tree swallow, which is, to my eyes, looks kind of random and sporadic, the way they're just flying over, say, a body of water and snatching as much as they can without a break. Whereas the olive-sided it's like a really pointed hunter. They're going after a thing and then going back to eat it on a nice branch.
Totally. It's sort of, I think the analogy is like a tree swallow is like a baleen whale, like a humpback whale, kind of cruising through the clouds of midges. You know, scooping up
with their mouth open.
Mouths open, scooping up, and nighthawks, yeah. The same, you know. And an olive-sided flycatcher is like an orca, you know, targeting, you know, that seal out there and going for it, right? And then, so it's a bit more, yeah. So they're a little bit different aerial insectivore in terms of their hunting strategy than some of the other ones, but all are still facing the same big threat, and that's the decline of insects, right? So this entire group, and I know we've said it, and we just had an episode about this, but aerial insectivores are one of the groups of birds that we are most concerned about at Birds Canada. They are one of the biggest declining groups of birds across the country and in North America, and olive-sided is no exception to that, and that's one of the reasons that they are a species at risk in this country, because their populations have been declining steadily since the 1970s.
When you drink coffee from Birds and Beans, you're supporting habitat preservation for our migrating birds. But how much habitat? A monthly subscription of 1 pound of coffee for a year will protect over 1,700 square feet of forest. That is a lot of forest for the olive-sided flycatcher. The more we drink, the more habitat gets protected. I love it. Head to birdsandbeans.ca to grab a bag of coffee or start a monthly subscription. They'll even donate 10% of your purchase to this podcast when you use the code WARBLERS at checkout. Yeah, and so of course the insect decline is part of that, but what other factors are coming to play there?
Yeah, so there are a few for olive-sided flycatcher. One, because they are a super migrant and they travel such huge distances, you know, habitat loss, whether it's on their breeding grounds, whether it's habitat loss on their non-breeding grounds in South America, and certainly, you know, tropical deforestation in the Andes, which, you know, you've talked about this before on the podcast with, you know, even coffee farming, you know, sun-grown coffee plantations being the result of, you know, deforestation in the tropics. You know, this is removing key habitat for birds like olive-sided flycatcher, amongst many others. So habitat loss and on migration as well. And with anything that's a long distance migrant, especially now, and we're seeing this with all long distance neotropical migratory birds, they're all declining, and climate change is definitely playing a part here. So climate change is another huge factor, and the asynchrony of when insects hatch and when birds arrive from their long journey, that trend is getting worse and worse and worse due to climate change. And that is really the big X factor with these birds. And you know, another one I have to say, because we don't say it enough, but pesticide use is another big one.
Yeah. Right?
So declining insects, you know, in the same sentence, you need to be talking about the rampant use of pesticides like neonicotinoids, you know, we cannot be using these things in the environment. And this is also another one of the problems affecting these aerial insectivores.
Yeah, I mean, it mirrors really perfectly that North America is heavy, heavy into pesticide use, and then our aerial insectivores are declining heavily, right? That's certainly a factor. And just expanding on that climate change thing a little bit more for folks, that what you're getting into is how the insects might hatch earlier than they normally would, but the birds are not coming back earlier because they haven't quite gotten the memo yet. For example, so they get back and that peak insect season's already ended, and then they're not able to refuel to the right degree right before they start nesting. Like that is kind of one way that climate change is impacting them and their prey.
Yeah, 100%, Andrea, and particularly for these long distance migrants, right? Birds mm-hmm. coming from South America and Central America, they don't know that spring has arrived early. You know, they don't know that insects are out, you know, 3 weeks ahead of schedule, and they're cued to migrate and to arrive based on changes in photoperiod. You know, that's what triggers them to migrate, the change in daylight. And and it's a problem. And yes, you know, people say, well, birds can adapt. Birds have adapted for thousands of years. They certainly can, but they cannot adapt at the rate that we are forcing them to. Right now, mm-hmm. the change is
happening so fast.
It's so mm-hmm. rapid right now, and they are not going to be able to adapt in the time frame that we as society have now put in place with this with global warming. So it's a real, it's a real challenge for sure. And there's stuff that we definitely need to be doing, and we need to be thinking about these birds and ourselves.
Oh, for sure. When the birds can't live in a habitat, that's a negative sign for how it's impacting us as well. Now, the olive-sided flycatcher is the avian ambassador for Birds Canada this year. Avian ambassador is kind of like a species that we choose to rally around and really get people excited about for a year. And I think I know a lot of the good reasons why we've chosen that bird, but could you expand on it for listeners a little bit?
Yeah, for sure. You know, I think with Birds Canada, one of Birds Canada's big annual fundraisers is the Birdathon, right? Oldest sponsored bird count in the world that we started many decades ago. And the every year we've always sort of like featured a bird on like our t-shirt and you know, we sort of have evolved that into really putting thought into like a focal species this year and trying to tell the stories of these birds a little bit more. And that's what we're doing. That's why we started the Avian Ambassador project in 2024 with Olive-sided Flycatcher being our first official avian ambassador. And to me, they're perfect because one, they're a bird that not a lot of people are familiar with, right? I like a lot of birds.
Myself included. I didn't know much about them before we selected it as an avian ambassador.
Yeah. And so I think what a great opportunity to like get people a little bit more aware of how amazing olive-sided flycatchers are, you know, and yeah, like they're not, you know, they're not a mountain bluebird. They're not a northern cardinal, right? They're not a puffin, right? They're more subtle. And so I think, but their story is incredible, right? So an opportunity to bring more attention to one of like the best boreal birds that we have for sure. Really incredible bird. But they also have an interesting story, right? The fact that they connect habitats in countries right across the Western Hemisphere. I really like that interconnectedness of their life story. And the fact that, you know, Birds Canada is now more heavily involved with the Conserva Aves program and helping protect important areas for non-breeding Canadian birds in the tropics, olive-sided flycatcher being one of them. You know, this is a species that is a high priority for areas that have been identified through Conserva Aves. So I really like that connection as well. And I think the last one for me is the boreal connection. You know, mm-hmm. they're a bird that is found right across the country in the boreal forest. I think the boreal forest is dealing with a lot of threats. And I think these are discussions and topics you'll be hearing more about in the coming months through Birds Canada. But they're a boreal bird. The boreal is facing a lot of change right now, and we're undertaking a really massive new program to do more work throughout Canada's boreal region. And so I just felt like the Olive-sided Flycatcher really connects sort of some key conservation priorities that we have. And let's just face it, like, they're awesome, right? How could you not look at an Olive-sided Flycatcher and not like be like, oh, I want to see one of these, because they really are pretty
totally
awesome.
And I mean, their song is so distinct that you'll be able to track them down because you'll hear it maybe before you see it, and that's kind of an exciting thing to work on and practice. But yeah, I'm excited to get more awareness for the boreal forest as well. I feel like we often hear about other countries, you hear about how the Amazon is being clear cut and burned and things like that. But we maybe don't always take as much ownership for what's happening in our own backyards. And the boreal is an incredible, incredible resource in Canada. And I think it needs more love. Super cool species to kind of get that conversation going a bit more. You did mention that we've got these birds on t-shirts. So I think we'll just like drop the link in our episode description. It's a really, really cool design. Well worth picking up an Olive-sided Flycatcher t-shirt this year.
I love our t-shirts this year.
So cool. Yeah. Yeah.
The design is incredible. I love it. Yes. Yeah.
I want a poster with it even. It's such a cool,
design. We've got stickers. No, really fantastic. Really fantastic design. And I'm really happy. It's great to be able to tell these stories.
Oh, I just heard your dog Max bark in the background. That must mean it's time to wrap up the call.
Yes, it's that time. It's that time of the morning where Max needs to go for a walk, of course. Really great to have an opportunity to talk about this bird. I hope people learn more about them.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for joining. And we'll have some links in our episode description so people can keep learning about the Olive-sided Flycatcher. The Warblers is a podcast of Birds Canada. Our goal is to bring you the information you need to discover, enjoy, and protect birds. If you like what you hear, please subscribe, leave a review, and share this podcast with everyone you know. Birds Canada relies on the support of donors like you. Visit birdscanada.org/warblerspodcast to make a donation today. The Warblers is produced by Jody Allair, Kate Dogleash, Chris Koo, and Andrea Gress, with music by Jose Mora and art by Alex Nickel. Until next time, keep birding.